This is a non-introductory level video on Grovable or dynamic arrays. The first video covers the basics that you should understand as an educated user. This one will go over some more advanced issues that most of us, including me, don't usually have to worry about. For people really implementing this stuff, hopefully they already know more about it than I do, so I don't know who's watching this, but if you want an appreciation of some of the issues behind the scenes, this should give you a peek. The video primarily deals with arrays which directly store objects or data instead of storing references to objects. I start by talking about the space versus time trade-off that you control with your growth factor, and then some optimization issues that can change based on how your memory is managed. That's also the good section to visualize how the structure sits within your computer's memory. I finish by looking at what happens if you store references instead of your data. Some languages don't really give you the choice, but if you have that choice, know the trade-offs. From an abstract, black box, don't worry about constants point of view, there isn't too much difference between directly storing objects compared to storing object references or pointers. But when you get into optimization issues, it matters. We start by assuming this former model that the data is sitting within the array itself. We already know that this data structure uses linear space and has average constant time insertion and deletion to the end of the list, but of course those constants can vary. For the introduction video, to make the analysis easy, we doubled the size when we grew the array. And right after that, you're using about 2n space to hold n items. Then, if we delete items until just before the data structure shrinks, which we said we'd do when we got down to the 1/4 level, we can get down to using only 1/4 of our array, which is a bit wasteful of your memory. You can be wasting 3/4 of what you're reserving. Those numbers are somewhat arbitrary. If we wanted, we could grow the array by only 50% instead of doubling it, and maybe shrink by 1/3 when under 1/2 full. That decreases the memory overhead of your data structure. It will always use at least half of the space reserved instead of only 1/4, but there's a trade-off. Modifying the insertion analysis from the first video for this smaller growth factor, each insertion now has to pay for 3 future copy operations instead of 2 to make our insertion analysis work out. Deletions now need time for 2 future copies instead of 1. Because we end up doing our expensive operations of reallocating and copying into a new array more often, the average amortized time per deletion and insertion goes up. This space versus time efficiency trade-off is really common in algorithms and data structures, and by changing your load factor or growth factor or whatever you want to call those numbers we picked, you pay with one to optimize the other. It's hard to simultaneously master both space and time. That's pretty abstract and theoretical. Now let's dive into more concrete memory management issues. If you're manually managing your own memory heap, good luck. Hopefully you aren't watching this freaking video for tips. But if you're using a language like C, I'll call that semi-automatic memory management. You allocate memory by request and manually free it when you're done, but you don't decide which memory block to allocate. It also has the realloc function, which I'll come back to. This array represents your memory. Some of the memory is in use, but I'm assuming that the light-colored stuff is currently unreserved. It might be empty, it might have some leftover junk in it, but it's part of the memory available to, but not currently used by, your program. So starting with a little growable array of size 4, the memory system gives us a block with enough space to hold 4 elements. For this diagram, each element takes up 3 units of memory. So great, you insert, and when the array is full, you insert again. For simplicity, let's use growth factor 2. Suppose I call the realloc function requesting room for 8 spaces. In this case, it looks just like a normal allocation. It allocates new space and then copies over the old data as quickly as it can. It's really optimized code and frees the old space. It can leave that old data just sitting in memory, but that data is no longer reserved and can be used for something else. The real difference comes when we grow this array past size 8. In this case, the space immediately after the array isn't reserved right now. And when we go to realloc to a size 16 array, there's enough room to just extend the current array size to 16. In this case, you don't need to copy anything over. The data from your old array is still being used, just with added capacity. When that happens, you get lucky, and one of your potentially slow insertions takes constant time instead of linear time. If your structure is dominating the memory used by your program, maybe this will happen a lot. Well, what if memory management is more automatic and we're forced to allocate a new array each time with little control over what memory is allocated? If your memory manager just allocates the first big enough block of memory that it has, growing by a factor of 2 has an extra disadvantage. Returning to our big strip of memory, each time you ask for a new array, you just take the earliest one available, doubling in size each time. Even though you keep on freeing up memory from your old arrays, there'll never be enough freed memory to use for a new array that you're allocating, even if nothing else ever gets in the way. Here, when I go to allocate a size 32 array, I just don't have space for it, even if I have enough memory for, let's say, 60 total items. I've freed room for 2 plus 4 plus 8 is 14 total items. But even if I were to include the 16 items I'm about to free up, there just isn't room. I'm going to extend past those 16 items. But if I take the 14 plus 16, that's 30 items. Maybe there's only room for 30 more items after that. There's not room for 32 items there either. The 16 items can't be freed up until I copy them. They're right in the middle, and basically, I don't have room for my 32. I never reuse my space, and I end up unable to allocate more space, even though I'm barely using a quarter of my memory, and nothing else is in my way. If you have a growth factor of under the golden ratio, about 1.6, you guarantee that eventually, if nothing else gets in your way, you can reuse freed space for your new array. Here we see that for our fifth allocation, we get to reuse space. If you go down to growth factor of about 1.32, the solution to some cubic formula, then the two previous arrays already freed prior to the one currently in use will have enough room for the next array you allocate. In this example, as things progress, with nothing else getting in the way, we'd expect every third allocation to go right back to the start and move on from there. I'm going to finish by considering the case when we store object references in the arrays instead of directly storing the objects. From a speed factor, directly storing objects is going to be much faster for accessing items, especially if you look at them in order. Sequential access of arrays is highly optimized. You have locality of reference. You might even be able to prefetch data, though that's not my area. Locality of reference will also help you if your data is stored to disk. If you get a page of data from disk and are looking at data in order, you bring in a whole bunch of stuff that you're about to need into memory all at once. Additionally, if the objects are small, the extra space overhead of the references themselves might be something you care about. There can also be some other issues caused by allocating lots of small objects. What are the advantages of storing references instead of objects? As the objects get larger, there are a few. The simplest one is that when you need to reallocate to a larger array, it's easier to copy over small references instead of huge objects. Also, the unused capacity within the array, it's better for that to be wasting room for just small references instead of large objects. Finally, if you start dealing with large numbers of large objects where total memory gets to be an issue, storing references has one important advantage. It needs one block of memory for the array of small references, but the individual objects can be spread all over your memory. Trying to get faster performance by storing a big block of objects doesn't get you anything if you can't get a big enough block of memory to do it. For segmented memory, maybe there's room to fit the objects you need if they're scattered all over the place, even if there isn't room for one big continuous block of memory holding all of the objects. It's the flip side payoff for that slower access. You get to sort of use all the memory you have, filling in all the gaps with your objects because they're all over the place. Well, that's it for this one. Check out the playlist. But I've got to go stomp Mario and Luigi.